honorable speaker Dr. Sanjan Hatwasser, teachers, librarians, research scholars, students, and other participants who have joined our webinar. Let me introduce myself. I, Shubhro Das, librarian, Dinobandhu Mahavidyalaya. On behalf of the Central Library of Dinobandhu Mahavidyalaya, I welcome you all from the depth of my heart. Thank you for being with us today. And I like to inform you that more than 600 registered participants are with us today from India and abroad. Today, our webinar topic, mode of teaching and learning in higher education in India during COVID-19 pandemic situation, is organized by the Central Library of Dinobandhu Mahavidyalaya in collaboration with IQAC. Friends, we are all aware that the spread of pandemic COVID-19 has drastically disrupted every aspect of human life, especially education. In many educational institutions, campuses around the world are closed, and teaching learning has moved up to online mode. Higher educational institutions of our country have reacted positively and managed to ensure the continuity of teaching and learning, research and service to the society with some tools and techniques during this pandemic for their effort also. Now, without you wasting your valuable time, I like to invite our respected principal, sir, Dr. Bishwajit Ghosh, to deliver his inaugural speech. Sir, please continue.
Thank you. Thank you, Shubhrata. Good morning, everybody. Today, we are familiar with the term Corona, lockdown, physical distancing, social bonding, and hot tea, lemon tea, ginger tea, hydroxychloroquine, and Oxford vaccine, education bill, and so many terms there. There is no proper solution today, still today. We are facing the problem during last four months. We need to run the education systems. In this situation, library, basically e-library, e-internet, e-books, e-journals, and e-education is essential for the coming time. We feel the need of modernized concept of library. That's why we have organized the webinar organized by our Department of Library. And we have today, we have Dr. Sudip Ranjan Hatua, Assistant Professor and Head of the Department, Library and Information Science, Rabindra Bharati University. First of all, I welcome, it's my privilege to welcome, sir. Sir, welcome to the webinar today. Sir, my heartiest welcome to all the coordinators. First of all, C. Shubhrata Das, and second, Srimati Sanjit Rai of my department, of my library department. My best wishes to both of them. I wish my NAC coordinator, Dr. Pooja Pal, my IQAC coordinator, Dr. Jenit Rai, and the other employees of my college, and I welcome, my heartiest welcome to all the participants from different parts of the country and from different part of the states and the student participants of this webinar. I welcome everybody who are present in this webinar, and my technical persons, basically Dr. Dr. Partha Sarathi Das, he is present now. I welcome Dr. Partha Sarathi Das and all the other technical persons who are involved with this webinar. Thanks to everybody. I think the webinar will be successful today. Thank you, everybody. I take the microphone, Shubhrata, and please continue. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Dr. Bishwajit Ghosh, sir, for your very encouraging inaugural speech. Dear participants, now let me give you a short introduction about our honorable speaker, Dr. Sudip Ranjan Hatua. Dr. Hatua awarded his master's degree in economics and bachelor of library and information science at Rabindra Bharati University. Afterwards, he completed master of library and information science course at Documentation Research and Training Center, DRTC, Bangalore. In the year 2009, Dr. Hatua completed his PhD from Vidyasagar University, thesis entitled a model for mapping internet resources for the generation of web-based information retrieval system, a case study of aerospace science and technology. Dr. Hatua started his professional career in the year 2001 as project assistant at National Aerospace Laboratory, Bangalore, followed by librarian Karshok Engineering College, Hyderabad, and technical assistant at Central Library, Indian Institute of Technology, IIT, Kharagpur. Year 2006, Dr. Hatua switched over from administrative job to academic arena and joined as faculty in the Department of Library and Information Science, Rabindra Bharati University. Dr. Sudhir Pranjan published more than 35 research articles in the peer-reviewed national and international journal. He awarded Yaslin Raghunathan Medal for Yaslin Best Article 2013. He has written more than 8 chapters in the proceedings of various national seminars, conferences, etc. He published 6 textbooks on library and information science with ISBN. His interest areas of research are many, more like application of ICT in library, library automation and networking, digital library, information retrieval system, database design, web-based searching system, library management software, open source software, web-based design and web-based information retrieval system, knowledge organization, and information retrieval. Now, I like to invite our honorable speaker, Dr. Sudhir Pranjan Hatua, to light us about the tools and techniques and its uses in higher educational institutions in India, and also for his presentation. Now the screen is yours, sir.
Thank you, Subrato. Am I audible and visible?
Yes.
So, thank you very much. You have given a exhaustive description about me. I could have forgotten all about myself. So it recalled me. I was thrilled that I have done so many things in the past. So it keeps me in something nostalgic that way I have crossed a long way. Anyway, thank you very much. So, Honorable Dr. Vishayit Ghosh, Principal Dinabandhu Mahavidyalaya, Dr. Jenith Roy, IQAC Director, Dr. Pooja Pal, NAC Coordinator, and Advisory Member, Faculty Members, respective members of Governing Body, Managing Committee, and the Convener, especially Shangyukta Roy and Subrata Das, dear colleagues, and OBC pants. I just use the new term, OBC pants, not participants. So OBC pants, it gives me an immense pleasure indeed to be a part of the national level webinar of teaching and learning in higher education in India during COVID-19 pandemic, jointly Dinabandhu Mahavidyalaya, Library, Central Library, and IQC Division. Thank you very much. And already principal sirs given few terms which are really our children used to know that what are the new terms. So we started with Janata Curfew. Probably sir has forgotten this term. We started with our journey with Janata Curfew, then lockdown 1, lockdown 2, unlock 1, and related lot of things social distancing sir has explained. So we are in very crucial time spending right now. All we are at home, and this is very interesting things that so many 600 participants, participants are here, and we are staying in different place, different country. That's the beauty that you should take at a positive thinking about coronavirus. If corona did not come, did not appear, we could not probably have a meeting such a very beautiful environment or a platform. So I like to switch over my presentation into slide sharing content. So I am offing these things, and straight away I am going to my presentation. So Subrato, please tell me whether it is visible properly or not. Hello? Hello.
Sir, it is visible.
Skin is visible.
visible, very clear, sir. No problem. Yes,
it's visible.
Okay, okay.
It's visible.
So as supervisor mentioned that we are going to discuss about higher education in India, its teaching, learning tools, technology, environment, and what we are facing right now during this COVID-19 pandemic, which started with maybe 14th of November first detected at Wuhan city, and slowly it spread all over the world. So this is the first case we have entered in this new era or new timings, new crucial and drastic timing, like from Wuhan city of China, tentatively it appeared at 14th or 17th November. There are a lot of dates controversy, and it had journey from China to Europe, then North America, then Latin America, then Central Asia to India, and we have first test positive, or we have detected corona at 30th January 2020, with a confirmed in Kerala Thrissur district in a students who had returned home for a vacation from Wuhan city. So this way the journey started, and we have entered in a new direction, and this is the beautiful background you can see had designed by I have taken it from Wikipedia, but it actually taken from the WHO or that UNESCO site, that it is the Indian scenario day to day affection record. I have taken it yesterday night, and today it has been changed. That's a 6 August has been detected in India, new detection 56,000. So what a alarming rate we are facing nowadays. So this is very crucial time we are having. So we can visualize the pandemic effect in it affects every sector. It affects every sector, socio-political, then so many things. Obviously, education sector is not apart from our society. So it affects harshly in education sector also. So this is the scenario, what education sector affected, how education sector affects by the corona pandemic, corona situation virus. So this is the UNESCO site. I have taken it from UNESCO site. Anybody can see this, and they have done a very interesting visualize matter that you can put your mouse over here, and you can see day to day what education, this particular in education sector, how education has been affected. So this data is showing that how in Indian scenario, you can put mouse over in any country, you can see the change of how education has been affected by this coronavirus globally. So this is the Indian scenario, and it has been detected on 3rd August. This Subroto's screen is appeared here. So okay, so this is the 3rd August. I have taken the slide, and if you put your mouse over, you can see the change every day only in education sector, how many people are affected, how many students are affected every day in various education sector. So now go to the, it has been stuck. So it affects the education sector of human life, economy to industry, socio-cultural, political course. Of course, in education, most of the government around the world have temporarily closed educational institution in attempt to contain the spread of COVID-19. And UNESCO estimated over 90.5 million students across the world, across 22 countries, including 32 crores in Indian students in school, college, and universities are affected as a result. Thinking of conventional mode of education, government has come up with e-learning programs. Lot of e-learning programs government has launched, and they are trying to introduce. So you see the learning system, how it has been changed. I have make it as a timeline. So we could have remember, everybody knows, we started our education system from Vedic period to even Chandragupta Maurya, a lot of huge time we spend, even Buddhist time also. That is Sufi type of things. So education started in a Tapovan or something like place, or Gurukul, such kind of things they started. And then we moved towards Tapovan system too, 18th century or first part of the 19th century, especially in our Bengal, in British period, in Tol and Sanskrit system. Then we moved into classroom teaching, say we call it in the 19th century, mid of the 19th or early 19th century, when British has started classroom teaching, in especially in India. And there we are very much familiar with chalk, duster, board, with Beth, of course. I have not mentioned here, Beth are very crucial part of our education system, lately. And finally, just few years, maybe two, three years back, we started, all of a sudden, that accreditation started, lot of NAC peer review team started visiting towards all the education systems, and RUSA funded has granted for Indian education sector, and we all of a sudden started our converting our conventional education classroom to smart class. And just few days it survived smart class. We started not yet accustomed with smart class, but all of a sudden this pandemic situation came, and what we found, virtual classroom. So smart class eliminated, now we are moving into the virtual classroom. I don't know how long it will survive or it will sustain, but what indicates it's maybe we have to sustain with virtual classroom only. So these are the changes I have mentioned here. And accordingly, if we little look back, that Indian education system, especially in higher education, as all of you know, that Indian education system is the third largest in the world, at least in context of student enrollment. A lot of students are enrolled here, so it is third after China, United States, then India. And as of 2016, latest data I not yet found, maybe I have to make word hard to get the latest 2019 data, but as of 2016, India had 799 universities, 39,700 colleges, and 11,923 standalone institutions. But as in January 2019, India has over 993 universities. So the growth of universities, number of universities, standalone institution is 10,775, and colleges 39,931. Sectors like central university or colleges. So in a decade back, India also started the distance learning program, which was another very very important part and significant role in world education system. Also, one of the biggest online learning courses are running here. So in spite of few shortcomings like less GER, gross enrollment ratio, infrastructure, teacher student ratio, research and research publications, etc., as a whole, India's higher education system is the world third largest in terms of student, next to China and United States. As Hindu, you know, the famous newspaper Hindu, he has reported August 21, 2019, that means almost a year back, that number of students enrolled in higher education system has gone up to 3.66 crore in 2017-18, and the GER rate enrolled rose to 25.4% in 2017-18, is targeted to 30% by 2020. So they are having lot of target that our gross enrollment ratio increase up to 30% by 2020. And for that, they have taken lot of initiatives. So if you look back in the higher education, if you see, there are three sectors are controlling our higher education. One is policy making sector, that is Department of Higher Education, Ministry of Human and Resource Development, Association of Indian Universities, Central Advisory Board of Education, State Council of Higher Education. They are policy making agencies, whereas the regulating authority, of course, college and university, if we talk about, all these things are run and controlled by university grant commissions. Probably their existence is under threat. Probably it is going to abolish the UGC. Okay, let for the timing, as UGC is there, we have to mention it. So UGC and AICT for engineering, MCI, PCI, DEC for distance learning, BCI, NCTE, ICAR, ICMR, ICSSR, CSIR, and state regulators. A lot of regulating authorities are there. They have mentioned each and every sector and specialist to every sectors. But in new educational policy, probably all these sectors will be merged and controlled by some single agency. So let it come. We will discuss later. But another thing is National Accreditation Body. Yes, we have national accreditation two bodies. One is National Board of Accreditation and second is National Assessment and Accreditation Council and NAAC, NAC. All we college and university fraternity, we all know about NAC. So these are the three sectors who runs our Indian higher education system. Now, when we talk about Indian higher education system, obviously, UGC, we cannot overlook the UGC because he is the main controlling authority. And immediately after pandemic declared probably 24th March, and before that 19th March, that Janta curfew was declared by Prime Minister Narendra Modi, then 24th March, it has been declared by lockdown one. And obviously, every you might have noticed that from Notbandi to lockdown two, everything has been declared. Meanwhile, there are something, Ghanta and Shankho, everything is there. All has been declared at 8 p.m. So evening 8 p.m. for Prime Minister Modi is very crucial. We should not overlook. Maybe one day it will be researched why 8 p.m. he has declared all these things. So India's higher education runs and controlled by three-tier system already I have mentioned. And on 19 March, Prime Minister Modi appeared in the television at 8 p.m. and it announced Janta curfew. On 24th March, then the same way he announced lockdown one, and 14th April, he announced lockdown two. And with all the socio-economic sector, total education sector faced a huge challenges with this lockdown. Obviously, while UGC started declaring a lot of mandates and a lot of directives from their own office, they need not to actually implement. We, the college teachers, students, and all other educational staffs, we are the forefront. We have to implement, but they need not to implement. They have to just make a directives, and they have given a lot of directives during this lockdown period. I would like to mention some of these directives which has appeared during this particular lockdown period from 24th March to recently. Okay, so this has provided a lot of mandates during this time, and first mandate immediately after lockdown appeared on 28 March 2020. Lockdowns, first lockdown one started in 20 April, and before, just few days before 28th March, 24th March lockdown started, and 28th March UGC has given a mandate for given a notification to overcome this situation and maintain with a statement that let this situation not impact our morale and productivity. That is part of that new mandate given by UGC in 28th March. Immediately after announced of the lockdown. And they announced 11 number of initiatives taken by all the higher education sectors in India. Those are listed here, like they started with Diksharamb. Probably many of us, we could not even know what is Diksharamb, what is the things are there, what are the guidelines and criteria. It is the student induction program they have mentioned. Then they have mentioned another initiatives called LOCF, that means Learning Outcome Based Curriculum Framework. Of course, this will be implemented in a major way in the new educational policy. That means we will not be able to provide the syllabus and course curricula what till date is running. We have to think about, we have to rethink for our curricular development, course development, subject choice, everything. Because we have to design your learning outcome based curriculum. That means after passing, student must get job. That way we have to design and framework our curricula. Third initiatives and mandate they have given, that Jivan Kaushal, curriculum for life skill. They have to develop life skill. Social and industry connect, fostering social responsibility and community engagement in higher education in India. And then, yeah, of course, all our especially research and those who are engaged in research and development, those who are engaged in teaching faculty, especially those who are in front of CAS, CAS or API, they know what does it mean CARE. So you have to publish your article in CARE journal. It is the Consortia for Academic and Research Ethics for publication and research paper. We are very much aware about CARE list. And then STRIDE, of course, to our in search for project, Scheme for Transdisciplinary Research for India's Developing Economy. Lot of projects can be adapted from STRIDE. Of course, it should have transdisciplinary research. Then SATAT, framework for eco-friendly and sustainable campus development. Green technology we are coming, we are thinking and we are coming up. Green technology or sustainable development. So our system, our environment, our classrooms, our campus, everything should be eco-friendly. Mulya Prabha, guideline for inclusion of human values and professional ethics. Every course curriculum, this should be added. How to introduce this new curriculum, one paper, one few projects, everything should be included for inclusion of human values and professional ethics. And evolution of reform in higher education, so will come later. Evolution reform will come in a big way. Total examination system will be changed, and a lot of committees have formed. They have given their recommendations, and that has been And Guru Dikshanto, faculty induction program for newly appointed faculty members. Paramars, scheme for mentoring NAC accreditation aspirants. Institution for promote quality assurance in higher education. That means college, universities, newly built up colleges, those who are not really accustomed about NAC accreditation or NAC evolution, when NAC team, peer review team used to visit the colleges, what to do, what not to do, that paramours can take the guidelines, can take these initiatives. So apart from these initiatives, Government of India took initiative for revitalizing infrastructure and system in education raised by 2020. By creating Higher Educational Finance Agency, HIFA has been tasked to mobilize rupees 1,000 crores, or 1 lakh crores for these initiatives. This will introduce SHUN by 2020. Lot of fund has been generated by Government of India, and that will be given to all the colleges and universities. But it is under new education policy. Government granted autonomy to university and colleges in three-tier grade autonomy regulatory system has been initiated. That means all college and university will be categorized in the three grade, category one type of college and university, category two, category three. And everything is available in new educational policy. Probably this is not the platform which we can discuss details of that things. They have formed National Institutional Ranking Framework. Recently, probably you might have noticed that there are a lot of national ranking list. And unfortunately, we are, especially in West Bengal, only two or three university or a few colleges have enlisted on that 100 ranking of Indian educational institutions. So we have to be very careful about that. So National Institution Ranking actually developed in 2015, but recently it has been adopted, or it has been pressed or emphasized very strictly. So now, and Swayam and MOOCs, that is also another initiatives government has taken, and probably that will be our future. In 11th April, UGC announced the next notification, 11th April 2020, the initiatives for Bharat Padhe online campaign. That means that already I have mentioned that by 2020, the gross enrollment ratio should increase by 30% to achieve the target. 11th April 2020, UGC has given another mandate, that is Bharat Padhe online campaign for, and there they inviting suggestion and sharing of ideas from the academic fraternity, including student, teachers, every stakeholders, to boost e-learning and intensify online education in India. That means today or tomorrow, whether we want or not, we have to go for online education system. And in 29th April, already second lockdown started. 29th April 2020, and most of the college and schools have been closed till date. So they given that on another mode of teaching learning process, how we will continue our teaching learning system in India, that is UGC mandate. And they provide that they said that using online mode such as Google Classroom, Google Hangout, Cisco Webex meeting, YouTube streaming, OER, Swayam platform, and Swayamprabha, everything could be a useful tool, could be used by the teaching fraternity to provide online education system. But there is a research, meanwhile, one faculty, Dr. Amita, the assistant professor, GMN College, Ambala Cantonment, she has made a research and found that initially, especially teaching community get very interested for going online teaching system. But as a tool, what they have used? They have used only WhatsApp and mailing group. They created WhatsApp group, mailing group for their students, and it has been found almost 37% teachers using students, whether they could able to search anything from internet, any required items for internet, whether they can able to fill their forms for any competitive examination or any something else, whether they are able to or not, that doesn't matter. But they are very much efficient, probably more than efficient than who has developed these devices like WhatsApp and Facebook. Teachers also taken this opportunity and they have used WhatsApp as a media for online teaching. And 75% or almost 76%, 75.96% used the provide the study materials. Actually, still it is there in our higher education system. Most of the teachers, it's the one-way teaching. They used to come to the classroom. We are also used to come to the classroom and we provide our lectures unidirectional. Slowly we provide the note to the students. Students used to write and they take it out. And if they get that teacher's note, students also very happy. So this way, a lot of teachers started providing their class notes in the PDF format, PPT format, or at least Word file format through WhatsApp or email. And that way, we thought that we are in online teaching learning method. But things are not like that. Obviously, only few people, a lot of young generation tech savvy teachers also come out. They prepare video lectures because now preparing creating video is very easy. You can use the YouTube, you can use, of course, a few days back TikTok. They used video lectures and spread to their student community, but that is very less, 27%. And are there who are you? Very few, only 2.38%. That means I am people are logging into Zoom or Google Meet. Zoom has been removed. People are afraid of using Zoom. God knows why people thought that Zoom has taken all the data, or there is no data security. What the data security is there in Google Meet? God knows. Nobody knows. So it's a what you can say, corporate war. They are corporate competition. So they are using all real-time classes only 2%, and any other sector they are using 2.72%. So these are the things. But after lockdown three, when a lot of discussion is going on about online teaching, how long classroom will be suspended, no class will be there, we are worried about that. So lot of another platform are coming popularity, going and getting popularity nowadays. So apart from Zoom and all this WhatsApp group, people are using some few extra things, because teaching and learning is not only we are teaching, not we are only we are providing the class lectures. It is not the end of teaching. By reading the lecture notes, students cannot reach cannot gain the knowledge. They can pass the examination, but they can succeed in life. So they have to consult, especially in higher education, in another things that is called learning resource. They have to consult lot of other resources. So there are various platforms, three category, and we will not end with this teaching learning process without evaluation. So education and learning depends on three factors. One is classes, second is lecture notes and documents, and learning resources, and third is evaluation pattern. So nowadays, in the conventional way, we had very well accepted tools and techniques and methods. We have a classroom, we have library, and we have teachers and notes, and we have a established educational pattern, examination pattern. That's the way. But things are changing. So nowadays, the usage of app for taking online classes are increasing. People are using Zoom, Google Meet, Google Classroom, YouTube Live, Team Link, like a lot of things. But I will request to concentrate one new startup app that is called Meet Now. Probably you are watching these things. That is Meet Now. It is Indian startup, very interesting. By in Google, you go and check the things. Meet Now. It not require any security, any email. Thing is, n number of people can log in here for n number of hours. So no registration, no time limit is required in Meet Now. For sharing lecture notes, documents, mostly people are using WhatsApp till date. Few are mails and YouTube, but still Google Classroom probably not get that much of boost up. Zoom are also, people are afraid about using Zoom, God knows, and websites. But mostly they are using WhatsApp. And finally, evaluation system. Evaluation system, we are not about discussed a lot last few months. We are only talking about lectures, classrooms, and providing class notes. But what about evaluation? Yes, evaluation has a very big issue nowadays. Will come later. But if you want to conduct online evaluation pattern, you can use Google Form and very interesting Ecolab. You can use here. So we will come later about evaluation. Yes, mode of examination. So in this pandemic situation, the mode of examination will be 50-50. A lot of discussions have happened during our teaching fraternity. What will be the mode of education? 50-50, 80-20, or compulsory through online, offline, or blended system will be decided by Supreme Court. It is under judgment of Supreme Court. So probably next 10th there is a next hearing. Of course, the alarming thing is Delhi High Court mandate. Sustain the examination pattern taken by Delhi University. Today's report is there. So we'll come later. So meanwhile, UGC declared One another thing, mode of examination, I am skipping these things. Yes, 20th July, UGC has declared Mono Darpan initiatives to provide psychological support. They thought that student might have got psychological problem, teachers might have got psychological problems in the staying at home. So they have given another mandate called Mono Darpan to support student, teachers and families for mental health and emotional well-being during this COVID outbreak. So examination it is coming in big way. We have to accept these things. Actually, current evaluation system, what we did, students used to come in the examination hall. They appeared for 2 hours or 3 hours or 4 hours. Old system, it was 4 hours. And new system in the CBCS system, semester basis, we are students are appearing 2 hours examination system. Basically, it is based on test of memory. Memory learning skill, how much they can memorize, not how much they have learned. Those who can have very good recitation power, they could have got highest rank. Those who don't have recitation power but can explain many things, but may not be suitable actual what the question has been asked, or he has very good very good student, but for that particular date or few for some surroundings, he may not be appear the examination. He may not be able to recite the things what he has learned since 1 year. So his result will be very bad. So this is the test we are having, the 2-3 hours examination, the sole tool to decide future career of the students. Issues of malpractice is there. Somebody you might have known, a very famous movie recently come out, that Munna Bhai MBBS, how one can get ranked. Today you know a lot of paper leaking in top level examination also. So malpractices in examination impact their credibility. They might have got highest result, but ultimately what they will be, that we all know. Therefore, a lot of reforms of the examination pattern will be coming soon with new national educational policy. How some good and bad things are also involved everywhere. It needs to be discussed later. Yes, if you want to go for real-time teaching learning process through online, you have to have follow SHAM, the learning management system. Only by using Google Meet or WhatsApp or streaming, teaching cannot follow. That means it cannot, at least you cannot get such flavor what we actually learn in classroom teaching. As there is a clear indication of teaching learning evolution process trend towards online and virtual mode, so we need to be accustomed with various open learning management system. Learning management system, we have to be very clear. And here, a librarian can play a very crucial role to build up a learning management system in a college or university. And Moodle is one of the best among them. Almost all the sophisticated institute are learning Moodle as a teaching learning system, and through Moodle they are providing online teaching. On online teaching system is running out. Students also very happy because this gives you the real flavor, actual flavor, what we are having in classroom. So Moodle is the one of the best and can be downloaded from as I have seen here, that download.moodle.org. This is a free open source software, can be downloaded here, and it is latest version is probably 5.19 something. From one can use free, and it is a free open source software, and you can use as a multilingual interface, all in one learning platform, all in one. That means I can teach, I can make a create a classroom here, I can provide document here, students can appear, we can see each other as if we are sitting in the classroom. They can interact, that means real-time interaction we can sort out here. Highly flexible and fully customized according to my requirement. I can customize my classroom, and it is scalable to any size. That means somebody may say that I have 230 students in one class. All can accommodate. Yes, all can accommodate here. So you can even for that you have to just download the software in your local server, and you have to make a setup, lot of documentation, and forum is there who will help you to establish, to install this system and to run the system properly. Apart from that, if you don't have the problem, or if you want to get a trial before the actual things, you can go for Moodle Cloud. Of course, even you can hire the Moodle Cloud. For that, you have to pay something, some little amount for Moodle Cloud. So if you go to Moodle Cloud, if you go to enter into the Moodle site, you will have one place called Moodle Cloud Free Trial. And there you will see the new Moodle ready to go started and already have an account. So you can go select any one of the things. Say you have selected new to Moodle. Then if you're new to Moodle, it will ask few things, probably your email ID or something, nothing else. And then you will enter into the Moodle virtual classroom, how it looks like. And you see, there are roles who all can enter into the Moodle classroom or Moodle platform. That means, like actual education system, for example, a college. College must have some classroom. College must have some administrative section. College must have some educational division, some lab. College must have some teaching fraternity, student fraternity. So this way, everybody has a separate role. Here also, anybody can make a separate role here. That is manager, or you are a teacher or student. Even parents can interact with the learning system. In the present situation, parents have to come and meet the teacher directly. Here they can meet with the teacher through online. And privacy officer, that means security control, who can do the security control. Here you can use, as a, I have used it as a teacher. So they have given the password for trial version teacher and Moodle teacher. And once you use it, you will see a very beautiful site, and a lot of facilities will be given there. So a librarian or of an institute can play this major role to set up the mentioned platform as a manager. He can coordinate various other role, operator like teachers, students, parents. Librarian can build a Moodle consortium to provide common online teaching learning management platform. So this way, teacher have librarian can have a great role to pay for online higher education. Now, learning cannot be fulfilled without resource and resource center. Now, a few couple of slides I will give you for in this pandemic situation, where a librarian cannot go to his, where librarian cannot access his physical documents, but students cannot get the physical documents, then what they can substitute it. A librarian, how they can help the students to get information from various sources, which is freely online available, and provide their required to the students. So learner, research scholar, students cannot learn by depending on the classroom lectures given by teachers. It was there in the time of Shruti. That time teachers used to tell student, student used to grab it, they could have memorized it, and they could have apply it in the society, and that learning process complete. Now learner need to consult various learning resources. A major support is given by the libraries in conventional system in the looking the future trend. most of the library already changed their mode. Many libraries started, many libraries completed. They have made their library automated. Most of them have started digital library system. Build their and provide online information to the document to the users. But problem is, no government, either central or state, or probably it is said that in a budget of any educational sector, especially in higher education sector, those two, you might have experienced, those who have completed their NAC accreditation, that a lot of RUSA fund used to come to the institute. And that those RUSA fund has been spent for building IT environment, not the real library or resource center. So it is said that library is the heart of any institute. Now it is lungs of any institute, but it has given less importance of any institutes budgetary allocation is the minimum for any institute to the library or development of learning resource center, but that is the backbone of any learner. That should be the backbone of any learner. So this government also neither funding or encouraging institutional learning resources. Rather, they tried to provide lot of fund to design and develop a central institutional repositories. One biggest example is they have developed during just few years back, it has been developed multi-crore project, National Digital Library of India. So this is the National Digital Library of India, have been funded by Ministry of HRD, and it has been controlled and run by IIT Kharagpur. Of course, what they are doing right now, they are providing around 5 and of course careful, we should not use that in their data from different digital library systems developed in different institutions in India and abroad. So in spite of these things, few amount they could have spent on different college and university learning resource centers, so that every institute in India, every college of in India could develop this kind of digital repositories, so that from there, now technology is very much available, anybody can access any university resource and any college resource center and get access of the information. So anyway, they have fetched only metadata and provide full text information, and have collect data for from school, CBSE examination repository, engineering, science, humanities, literature, law, management, and this way 5 lakhs documents are available. I will request every participants and user to promote this National Digital Library of India to their stakeholders, to their patrons, so that as long as your university, your college, your academic institution is shut down, they can access information from here. Even for children, school going children, lot of CBSE, ICSE papers are there, so it can easily downloadable, it can easily readable. So, and during this COVID period, they have started creating another things that is called COVID-19 research repository. That's the biggest source of online information. To provide support, NDL they have given educational materials available from now come to the OER, Open Educational Resource. Open Educational Resource as a teaching learning resource material in any media, digital and otherwise. Here also one thing. Actually have found 1,000 documents, online documents, freely available in high quality documents, and you have seen the in bracket it is given how much documents are there. If you go in this site, you will get a lot of things, and I will request their material types. To material types, all librarians, generally conventional library, we used to arrange our materials by book, journals, or thesis or dissertation. Not the we have designed classify their documents. In near future, librarians should change their mode of arrangement like this way. Not only the textbook journals, they should have made a section where they can put the, like lab reports, assessment, course materials. All the class lectures should be featured so that it can be referred. Then reading materials, lot of modules, lesson plan, syllabus, everything should be there in library. So this way they can arrange. So apart from that, you can go here, www.oercommons.org. Now apart from that, National Repository for Open Education Resource, they also provide lot of information, ebooks, free of cost. One can access for that from nioer.gov.in. Yes. Apart from that, you can go get NIOS, National Institute of Open Schooling, FOSSI, lot of software, Sijatra, etc. Diksha, very important e-learning platform. Of course, this e-learning platform is for school children, but guardian, parents, or participants who have child of class 1 standard to 12 standard, please refer this Diksha e-learning portal. You might have seen a lot of portals are available, a lot of Baiju. You might have seen the Baiju. They have given a huge advertisement in the TV. You can go for Diksha online. It is not less qualitative than a Baiju. It's a very beautiful site. I request you to go through this site. Yes, Consortia for Educational Commons. They are given by the Ministry of HRD. It provides the learning tools, resources, and courses under MOOCs and under Open Educational Resource. Lot of things are available, even YouTube channels also there for learning, online classroom. For higher education, of course, many people, many students might have known, but librarians also endorse these things, that is EPG Parsala. It provides higher quality curriculum-based interactive e-content in 70 subjects across all the disciplines of social science, arts, fine arts, and humanities, natural and mathematical sciences. We have e-Odhayan, which provides 700 e-books for postgraduate courses. E-Pathya is a software-driven course content package that facilitates the students pursuing higher education, especially PG level. And obviously, UGC MOOCs are there. Lot of students are enrolled, around a few lakhs students have enrolled during this COVID period for UGC Shyam project. NPTEL, another very important online resource repository or sources, that is a project funded by MHRD. It provides largest online repository in the world in case of engineering and basic science and selected humanities and social science subjects. And apart from that, it provides more than 56,000 hours of video content and 417 courses across discipline are being offered by for certification. So NPTEL, most of the engineering college, they knows about NPTEL, and you should have get linked with this NPTEL site. Yes, another platform. This is not only the resource center, but like Moodle, you can go for Brihaspati. Brihaspati is very popular online platform for online teaching and education, a platform independent, highly scalable content deliver tools for web-based e-learning system. It is developed by IIT Kanpur. A-Tutor, it is also open source library management learning management software, used to develop and manage online courses and to create the distribute interoperable e-learning content. I should have skip a little quicker because 12 o'clock is going on. So these are the things. Yes, Khan Academy. I said that Baiju or just few slides back, I mentioned that Diksha Online, like that, and go for Khan Academy, ESS India, CK12. All for school children. Almost everybody in our house, we have children, our relatives, our son, daughter. They are probably in class 1 to 12 standard. We can have a very, very beautiful online open education resources from Khan Academy. I will suggest use Khan Academy also. So, online learning. There are many things. I think librarian is more enough to provide such kind of lot of online learning resources are available. But while talking about online teaching and learning, is not only the library of video. Online learning does not mean online platform does not mean we are providing few video lectures through YouTube or provide some ebooks or provide some content. It's not like that. Subject matter covered in the classroom is to be delivered online, but with the technology as a intermediary. Not we should provide the technology is the priority. it should have an intermediary system, but our classroom teaching, the methodology, the way teacher talk to the student, so that student can accustomed with that. Generally in the classroom, we use lot of examples, lot of story we tell to the student to motivate. So that should be included. Apart from that, if we provide, if you go through online video lectures provided by IGNU or some other open education system, you will see it is a monotonous, continuous, people are talking, and how student will grasp what they are interacting, nobody knows. So that can be avoided through online teaching learning environment, not the online class lectures. So it requires a great deal of understanding and application of learning science and digital pedagogy. Put learning science, not the technology, in the forefront. We have to provide the highest emphasis on learning science. A multi-pronged strategy is necessary to manage this crisis and build a resilient Indian education system in the long term. Open source digital learning solution and learning management software would adopt to show that teachers can conduct the teaching online, and how librarian can make a major role, because every sector, whether we give importance or not, that is another issue. But librarian or library is an important stakeholders to create open learning environment and OLR. Even in the Moodle, it is the one of the biggest wing to set Moodle. It provides a common single interface. All librarians now have a new job. Librarians already we have crossed, or we have saturated with automation. We have saturated in digital library system. Now librarians need to provide an open, a single interface. I have mentioned so many open educational resources. Now a student need not know, or they may not be knowing each and every link, each and every resources. Right now I have mentioned probably 8 or 9 online education resources, full high reached education sources. How many of you know that link, that I have to go one by one link, and if I satisfied then I go, if I don't satisfy I have to go to the another link? Rather, a librarian could provide a single interface. From that single interface, he should link all the links, so when user will search their requirement, it will not give billions of records like Google gives. Rather, it will give the right information, right subject matters, right course content from this selected well managed, or you can say reviewed, course material or notes, and they can access it from a single user interface. And from where it is coming, user may not be knowing, and then may not be interested. Obviously, right, that way librarian should provide right information to the teacher to build online courses, class lectures, and to students for selecting right courseware, right information and direction for future path. That is the basic information for basic activity during this pandemic situation of a library. So new educational policy is coming up, where three tier grade autonomy regulatory system will be set up. We should be very careful of that. Let it come. Let a lot of discussion is going throughout the India. So, but people are, government are very strict. They are going to implement very soon. So major changes going to be happened in near future. Before my conclusion, I would like to draw your attention with these few pictures. There are a lot of pictures are there. So why I am mentioning this? Because a few debate is growing or discussing everywhere nowadays, especially related to examination pattern. We are a lot of file has been sued in Supreme Court, and a lot of discussion is going on how question is, in these socio-economic conditions where people don't have enough food, people don't have enough bandwidth, people don't have money to purchase smartphone or electricity, avail this new online teaching methodology, or they can adopt this new system. Yes, that is the big burning issue. But I would mention to these great people, there are so many, right from Michael Faraday, Alfred Nobel, Srinivas Ramanujam, APJ Abdul Kalam, even Sundar Pichai, you know, from what is their background, what are their education, family background. Are they are very rich family, but still people remember them forever. And especially I will mention, then probably may not be knowing this, few young guys, say Hassan Safin. His mother was a roti maker in local restaurant. Kuldeep Divedi is a son of a security guard. Tapasya Parihar is a daughter of a farmer. Sivagaru Prabhakaran worked as a sawmill operator. Prema Jayakumar, daughter of her auto rickshaw driver. What they are all IAS topper, the biggest examination in India, toughest examination in India. They cleared all this IAS topper, and this Prema Jayakumar is a CA, chartered accountant topper. So what I want to mention that poverty, starvation, lack of facility cannot stop a genuine learner. If you want to learn, say few days back, when government to implement our CBCS system throughout India, lot of complaints, lot of problems arises. But now we have almost accustomed in the CBCS system. So tomorrow we will be accustomed with new online educational mode, and we have to, otherwise we will be probably in grade C or third category institution. We will not get students, those who will who want to be learned, they have to go the first grade student, category 1, category 2, category 3. Keeping in mind, in near future we have to accustom slowly, and that bandwidth, price, starvation will not stop. That will not be excuse. So I think with this I might have able to share few of my thought regarding this present higher education situation in India. So where there is a will, there is a way. Nothing can stop to learn, and everything, being a man, being a human being, we can adopt everything. Manush obhase tas jodi baddho hoi, jodi proyojon pore, we will accommodate everything. So this hope I like to conclude, and thank to the college authority, convener Subroto and principal sir, to giving me this opportunity to share my thought. Thank you very much.
But to Subroto. Thank you sir for your very informative and knowledgeable session. After your presentation we learn many new modes of learning, new perspectives, new trends that are emerged, and the same may continue as we go ahead to a new tomorrow. I feel that you have made us enriched today. Thank you very much, sir. Now I like to invite my colleague Songjukta Aloy to continue the next session.
Good afternoon everyone. I hope I'm audible. So before we start our interactive session, I would like to express our heartfelt gratitude to Dr. Sudip Ranjan Hatua for his brainstorming session, which has focused on sustainability in higher education institutions in the recent pandemic crisis situation. And we congratulate him for this beautiful presentation in an articulate manner. We are enriched, sir, because you have given a presentation starting from Shruti and Smriti to this contemporary situation of online platforms, plethora of e-resources, e-modules, a new education policy in the light of new education policy. So we will take some pertinent questions only from the participants, if we have it, some questions, okay, on behalf of the participants. Yeah, is there any question? Respected all concerned, can you hear me? Is there any question? Hello?
Madam, you see the chat box.
Yeah, actually, I think we should I've jotted down some questions that they are asking for PPT, because this has been a wonderful presentation in a very articulate manner, very informative. Thank you, Dr. Hatua, for such a, we are just awestruck. So informative. We have touched almost all the aspects in this contemporary situation in the light of the present educational policy, the new educational policy. And dear participants, is there any question? So most of the participants, they are asking for the PPT. They would like to have the PPT. Yeah.
Ma'am, I think it is a YouTube streaming is going on.
Okay.
Oh, so from there they can have the whole document.
Yes. So dear participants, as you can hear Dr. Hatua, that you can have the entire presentation, which has been live streaming on YouTube channel. And let us express our heartfelt gratitude to Dr. Vishwajit Ghosh, Principal DVM, under whose aegis this webinar could have been possible. And next, I would like to extend my gratitude to advisory members from the IQSE, Dr. Sujit Kumar Kaur, Associate Professor, Department of Mathematics, Dr. Zenith Roy, Director, IQSE, Associate Professor of the Department of English, Abhinavondo Mahavidyalaya. Next is Dr. Pooja Pal, Assistant Professor of Chemistry. She is presently the NAC coordinator for our institution. And last but not the least, we express our heartfelt gratitude to the technical support team, Mr. Shushabha, Assistant Professor in the Department of Computer Science of our college. Next is Dr. Ajay Mollick, the ever ready and helpful Dr. Ajay Mollick, Assistant Professor in the Department of Zoology. And next is Dr. Partho Sharati Dash, Assistant Librarian and Information Officer of National Library of India. So we thank you all. I think we have come to the conclusion. It has been really an awesome session, brainstorming, thought-provoking. Okay. So thank you all. Shubroto, over to you. Shubroto, can you hear me? Shubroto?
Yes, I'm hearing you.
Okay, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Last but not the least, that important announcement to make. Okay, that feedback link for the feedback form will be given very soon. And provided you fill up the form correctly, you will be getting the certificate in no time. And there is an important announcement. Shubroto, I would like to ask you to do the announcement.
A small announcement for our participants is that our next webinar will be scheduled on 14th August at 4 p.m. Topic of the webinar is Community Education Through Libraries, Tagore's Thought and Implementation, Robindra Bhavnai Gramin Shikha O Library Bhumika, Ekti Alochana. Medium of webinar is Bengali. Okay, Sangeet.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's absolutely fine, Shubroto. So, yes, sir. Principal, sir.
Thank you, sir. Participants, all the participants. That's the end of the webinar. Okay.
Okay, thank you, Principal, sir.
We can leave the platform now. Okay, thank you, everybody. Thanks, sir.
Thank you,
okay.
Sir.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Have a good day.
Okay, thank you. Thank you and goodbye to all.
Yeah, have a good day.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.